Now, the question on everyone's mind is, clearly, there are still no specific individuals named in the ICC probe. I think, let's put that out there.
Yes.
It is assumed that it is former President Duterte because it was his drug war, but technically, there are no names involved. So the question is, you being the Solicitor General, why are we pouring in government resources, your time, the president being interviewed on this, when hypothetically, if it is the former president, it was his drug war, he's now a civilian, why is the government protecting him and others? What is the business of this government not wanting justice for its people, not wanting transparency? Kumbaga, ang lumalabas, ang gobyernong ito, nag-aabala, we are lawyering you, not personally, but the government is now lawyering, not for the country, but for specific individuals who can be, who is one, possibly, if he's included in the case, a civilian. Why is the government defending, protecting people in people who may be guilty instead of its own interests, which are people who are victims of the drug war? That's the question on everyone's mind. Why are you defending, protecting people who could be guilty?
Karen, I have already explained this point several times before, and I have clarified that.
And it's not personal, it's not as a lawyer.
Of course, of course.
Not at all.
Right.
It's the post.
Right. And I have repeatedly explained that the office of the Solicitor General is the Council of the Republic of the Philippines. Mm. We're not lawyering for any particular individual, more so if the individual is charged criminally. Mm. All right, so we are defending, in effect, the principle that our domestic judicial and legal system is functioning. And for that reason, there is no basis for an international entity like the ICC to impose upon ourselves their own type of investigation, because our own system is working. It may be not to their liking, but that is not a sufficient ground for them to take over the investigation that our own system is already doing. Mm. That's our main point. The OSG is protecting the system that we have here in our country, regardless of who may be the individuals who may be charged in the future. We're not looking at that anymore. Mm-hmm. What we're protecting is our sovereign right to do our own investigation in our own way, within the framework of our own legal and judicial system. That's all that we want to project to the ICC. We're not protecting anyone. Mm-hmm. That's farthest from our mind.
Okay, then Solgen, I mean, this is way before your time. If this was the argument of the Philippines, why did we join the ICC in the first place? This isn't like the United States. The United States did help craft the ICC, but the irony is they never joined the ICC. I'm correct?
Yes,
right?
That's true.
But the irony is the Philippines joined the ICC. This was the time of former President Noynoy Aquino. And no less than President Marcos Jr., when he was a senator, voted on August 23, 2011 to ratify the Rome Statute. Mm-hmm. Former President Marcos didn't question during the Senate hearings. He didn't express reservations. In other words, if this is the argument today, then why did we join it in the first place, right? By joining the ICC, we as a country, and not personally, we're saying we recognize that you can investigate crimes against humanity. Mm-hmm. We recognize your power, your authority, your jurisdiction. Why did we do that in the first place if we're saying now our courts are working? And that was under Aquino's time.
Right, right. Well, we joined the ICC because we believe that crimes of that magnitude should really be investigated and prosecuted by a much bigger tribunal than the local tribunals. Imagine the four crimes that the ICC can investigate genocide, war crimes, war of aggression or crimes of aggression, and crimes against humanity. So, you know, the magnitude of these offenses is so much that probably a local court will not be able to independently and efficiently handle such crimes, no? So in our case, we are saying that the war on drugs does not even fall under any of those four categories. We do not consider the war on drugs as a crime against humanity because it's a legitimate law enforcement operation. It's called war on drugs. It's not a war on drug users or a war on drug pushers. No, it's a war against the crime itself. We're trying to address that situation. In the course of that campaign, however, many people died. But
6,185, I think. That's the PNP numbers.
Yes, okay, apparently.
Yes, go ahead. But then it's believed to be more than 10,000, but go on.
Yes, so what I'm saying is that operation called War on Drugs does not fit the concept of a crime against humanity. Okay, so we're disputing that. And that is very well explained in our own submissions to the ICC pretrial chamber. Well, of course, somehow we mentioned it again in the appeals brief of the Philippine government. But that's our main point. So when this whole investigation about the war on drugs turned to be, from the president's point of view, something like, there seems to be some political agenda involved in it, and the ICC seems to be somehow cooperating in that, in one sense, the president thought it proper. Mag-withdraw na lang tayo dyan. Mm-hmm. Let's just withdraw. Mm-mm. Okay, because it's not serving its purpose anymore.
Mm-mm. But do you believe the ICC has a political agenda?
It's hard to say. Some people would say na it's rather obvious. So that is a possibility. I can't really, speculate on what's going on in the minds of the justices of the ICC. So tayo na lang ang mag-judge. Let's judge the ICC by their own actions. As a lawyer, I tend to, give credence and good faith to all that our courts and prosecutors are doing as a lawyer. But I'm not a political leader.
Yeah.
And therefore, my views regarding political motives would be irrelevant. So I leave that to the political leadership.
And I wanted to ask you, I mean, just by speaking to you right now, because I've interviewed you many times on Head Start as Justice Secretary, just to lighten the moment a bit, is it difficult for you? I mean, given that you were Justice Secretary under the time of former President Duterte, where the war on drugs was actually implemented. So I remember all our interviews during that particular time, and you did issue strict statements on, frankly speaking, I remember, abuse of enforcers. You said that on Head Start. Yes, there are abuses, and you don't tolerate that. And now you're wearing a different hat.
No, I have always been consistent. When I explained or declared to the public that there were abuses committed during the war on drugs, not only in your program, but even before the UN Human Rights Council, I made that disclosure. Of course, I knew that it would probably upset some people in the government, but that's a fact. And I had to inform the public of the findings of the Department of Justice during my time. Yun ang nakita namin, so I had to report it. And the president himself also admits that there were abuses during the war on drugs. So what am I doing now as Solicitor General? I am telling the people that the government is now investigating those very people who we found to have abused the war on drugs. So I'm just saying that to the ICC, we're already doing it. You don't need to come in because we're already doing it. So there's no inconsistency between what I'm saying now as Solicitor General and what I said before as Justice Secretary. They're actually a continuation of each other.
Mm. But do you think while our courts are working, do you honestly believe that our courts would be able to, at this point on the war on drugs, frankly, charge a former president or even a sitting senator or anyone in office?
It depends on the evidence, because an investigation will have to be done first, all right? And if the evidence shows some complicity on the part of the president, then the appropriate charges will have to be filed in court. So let's leave it at that. It all depends on the evidence. What evidence is there to show actual complicity or direct orders of the president for a law enforcement agent to commit a crime? So did his orders constitute a crime? So that is for the investigation to find out. But of course, we trust that if evidence is sufficient, the courts will not have second thoughts about trying a former president. We have seen that many times before. We had two presidents who were charged in court. So why would a third one be not possible?
Okay. All right. Justice Secretary Remulla said, when I asked him, are we sending mixed messages that we don't recognize the jurisdiction and yet we're filing appeals? He said, well, it's really for diplomacy purposes. Do you agree with that?
Well, not really for diplomacy. We have engaged with the ICC, even if we do not recognize its jurisdiction anymore, out of committee, more of out of committee, being a former member state. In other words, we conducted dialogues with the ICC prosecutor in the hope that he will see the light and would not proceed anymore to conduct his own investigation, because he'll be convinced that anyway the Philippine government is doing its own. So that's all that we wanted to show them. And in fact, they requested us to provide them information that would show that we're already dealing with the problem, with the matter. So we, out of committee, we engaged with them to continue a dialogue with them. But after submitting all that they have requested, they concluded that, sorry, this is not sufficient. So they ask now the pretrial chamber to commence their formal investigation. But when that happened, our withdrawal had already become effective. So that's what we're pointing out now.
Do you think this affects us in the world of nations, considering President Marcos Jr. has taken the time to sell the Philippines all over the world? We've seen it in his travels. He's welcomed by Western world leaders. We know how the European Union really stands by the ICC. In fact, the last visitor of the EU Human Rights Committee said, we've given up our own sovereignty and our own personal rights in belief of the ICC for something greater, right? That's the whole belief system of the EU, which is quite admirable to a degree. But how does this affect us as a country in the world of nations that we don't want to cooperate with the ICC?
You know, Karen, I think we should view it not only with respect to the Philippines' responsibility as a member of the international community. We should also view it insofar as the ICC itself is concerned. Is the ICC following its own principle of complementarity?
Are they?
Because that's...
Are they?
No. Okay. Insofar as we are concerned, the complementarity principle that underlies the workings of the ICC is not being followed by the ICC itself. That's what we're saying now. So complementarity means the primary responsibility to investigate and prosecute belongs to the member state. Your role is simply complementary. Only when there is no genuine investigation and prosecution being conducted by the domestic institutions may you come in. But you are coming in despite the fact that we are doing what needs to be done in a genuine manner. So it's you, ICC, who is not following your own principles.
That's a good argument. Another one I'm curious is, in terms of alleged biases, there were observations that the ICC actually refuses to investigate countries like the United States, abuses of their soldiers in Afghanistan. I'm just curious, and yet it would concentrate on African countries.
I cannot speculate on the motives of the ICC. Yeah. Maybe yun lang ang kaya nila.
So, Soljen, naniniwala po ba kayo there's no benefit in the Philippines rejoining the ICC? When the EU parliamentarians came, they were, of course, hoping that the Philippines would rejoin the ICC. Should we rejoin the ICC, Soljen?
Karen, you know, it's a political decision to make. It's not for me to make a recommendation to the president regarding that. But by the way the ICC has been conducting itself, I personally tend to agree with the president, current president, that it's not really a good time to consider rejoining the ICC. Maybe we need to see some changes, some reforms in the ICC before we consider rejoining the ICC.
Still with the ICC, what's going on right now is the ICC declining the appeal of the Philippines for a suspensive effect first, but then there is still a main appeal right now with the ICC. President Marcos Jr. has said, we will disengage. So, Solicitor General, do you believe that if the president, hypothetically, because you will still send him a clarificatory explanation, right, of the status of the Philippines, or frankly, they could be watching right now. If the president says, Soljen, dinidecline naman nila ng dinidecline, dalawa na eh. Huwag na natin ituloy. Huwag na talaga, hayaan na lang yung appeal na yan. Hindi tayo magre-respond. Kung ano man ang decision nila, we'll leave it alone. What is, just look beyond, look 10 years ahead, when you're out of office, when he's out of office, what could be the effect to the Philippines if we leave it hanging?
No, we will not leave it hanging. We will actually wait for the decision of the appeals chamber. Unless, of course, the order is, let's just withdraw the appeal, because it would appear to us that the ICC had already prejudged, because that's the very thing subject of the appeal. Stop the investigation, because we're already doing it. That's the main substance of the appeal. But while that matter is pending, the ICC ordered the investigation to proceed. So isn't that already, in a way, a prejudgment or a vision of the things to come? So why do we have to bother to wait for that decision? Let's just withdraw it. They have, in fact, prejudged already our appeal. So that is a scenario that is possible. Although, of course, we have gone this far. Who knows if the justices of the appeals chamber will be enlightened? And so let's leave that possibility open. Let's just wait for it. We don't need to do anything further, as the president correctly stated. But let's wait for that judgment to come.
What will a withdrawal mean for the country?
Withdrawal of the appeal?
Yeah.
Then, in that case...
Because the president might surprise you. Who knows? And say, okay, Solicitor General Guevara, withdraw... I'm not saying he should, but I'm just saying, what if? What's the consequence?
All right, the consequence of that is the investigation being now conducted by the prosecutor will proceed even more vigorously, and anything could happen after that. Now, when certain individuals get indicted by the prosecutor, then the lawyers of those individuals indicted will take over. So they will now defend these specific individuals who might be indicted by the prosecutor. The office of the Solicitor General will not represent those individuals, because that's not our mandate. Our mandate is to defend the state, not the individuals who might be criminally charged at some future time. So that's another battle the battle between the specific individuals indicted against the ICC prosecutor. That's a totally different war.
This is interesting. So when we were off air, we were talking about alleged protection, and you stated, I think maybe as a closing note, that you're not here to protect anyone. This is not a question of protecting specific individuals.
Yes, Karen, I mean that because what I'm defending is the responsibility or the primacy of the state in conducting its own investigation of crimes committed with its own territory. That's the main thing there, regardless who the individuals may be involved in some future prosecution. We do not really care much about that. What we're after is to protect the integrity and independence of our own system, free from the impositions of any international entity like the International Criminal Court.
All right, on that note, before we go, I want to lighten it before we go, because this was such a passionate discussion on your end, and I want you to come back. Is, how do you like your new job?
I like it very much. I'm a lawyer, and that's the biggest law firm.
Do you like this better than being Justice Secretary? No administration mentioned, but the job itself.
I like both, except that the work at the OSG is more focused, being a law firm. At the DOJ, you have to deal with many administrative matters like the BUCOR, the Bureau of Immigration, the Land Registration Authority. So a lot more areas to cover.
Yeah.
But the OSG, the work is focused on lawyering, on litigation.
All right. Well, on that note, I want to thank you once again for coming and just taking the time to really explain.
It's always my pleasure.
It's a pleasure. The consequences, what can happen, and the next move. Thank you so much, Solicitor General. That's Solicitor General Menardo Guevara, live on Head Start today.